Just imagine a simple sugar molecule like glucose. With a little bit of difference in the number of atoms, we can have another sugar molecule called deoxyribose. Now this sugar combines two phosphates and a nitrogen base here. We call them nitrogen bases because of these nitrogen atoms. There are different types of them, but four of them most likely would bind to this sugar molecule, which makes four different units. These units can bind to each other and make a long chain, and these bases are very reactive because of these nitrogens in here, and they're going to bind to another specific unit. So always, adenine binds to thymine and guanine binds to cytosine. And that's how a source code that is essential for all known forms of life, which we call DNA molecule, forms. Our bodies use these pieces of information and make functional proteins to do a lot of jobs in our cells. For making proteins, first the code in the DNA should be transcribed to another molecule called mRNA, and then it can be translated to proteins. For making mRNA, first the two chains of DNA should be separated, and an enzyme called RNA polymerase make mRNA from this chain. Since the two chains in the DNA are complementary, the mRNA code would be exactly like the opposite strand. So for simplicity, we call this chain positive strand and this chain negative strand. This mechanism is not exclusively just for us. Actually, bacteria have DNA and they make mRNA to make their necessary proteins. Viruses have the same thing, but the exception is viruses have different forms of genetic materials and different viruses have different mechanisms for making mRNA. So we can classify them based on how they can make mRNA from their genetic materials. Based on this classification, which the specific name is Baltimore Classification, we have seven different types of viruses. The first group has double-strand DNA like us, and they make their mRNA similar to how we make them. The second group has single-stranded DNA, and after entering the cells, first a double-strand DNA forms with the help of a specific enzyme called DNA polymerase, and then they can be transcribed to mRNA. The third, fourth, and fifth Baltimore groups have RNA as genetic materials. It can be a double-strand RNA in which now you have positive and negative strand RNA because viruses that have double-strand RNA have a specific enzyme that can make mRNA from the double-strand RNA. The two next group have a single-strand RNA which can be the positive or negative strand. The positive single-strand RNA can directly act as an mRNA because it has the same genetic code. But the negative strand RNA should be transcribed to a positive strand with the help of a specific enzyme called RDRP. A newly synthesized RNA can be used as an mRNA. We have another two different types of viruses that act a little bit differently compared to others. One of them has double-strand DNA and the other one has a positive single-strand RNA. This group doesn't translate their mRNA right away like group 4. Instead, they have a very special enzyme called reverse transcriptase that can make double-strand DNA from this RNA. Then they integrate it into the host genome. Group 7 have the RDRP and reverse transcriptase enzyme, but their genetic material is a double-strand DNA with an RNA intermediate. Now recently, people are talking a lot about coronavirus and monkeypox, and they're trying to compare them. But to be honest, they belong to completely different groups. The coronavirus has a positive sense single-strand RNA, but monkeypox has a double-strand DNA. Since the coronavirus requires RNA polymerase for making mRNA, and this enzyme doesn't have the proofreading ability, the mutation rate is substantially high compared to DNA viruses. Besides, their behavior is totally different from each other. So in my opinion, we should think about them differently and try to address the problem as it is. Thank you for watching.